Jai Hind. Today we move on to the next date, that is 23rd of October 1947. As we saw in the last video, by the wee hours of 23rd October, that is around 4 o'clock in the morning, Brigadier Rajendra Singh with his handful of soldiers had reached Uri. More than 6,000 so-called raiders were already in Dumail. They had plundered Muzaffarabad and they had eaten up Dumail and they were plundering countryside. At the same time, to the south of Dumail, around 6 kilometers, was Kotli, where a small detachment, there were 30 soldiers of Jack Infantry of same battalion, 4 Jack Riff, which was overrun earlier on 22nd due to treachery. Naik Santaram was the platoon commander, and by 23rd morning, by this time at 4 o'clock, all Muslim soldiers had just walked away, leaving Santaram with 9 soldiers. Luckily for them, the Muslim soldiers who had crossed over did not hurt these 9 people, unlike what they did in Muzaffarabad. So at around 4 o'clock in the morning, Santaram had collected his 9 men. They were attacked twice. So while they were not killed by their colleagues, while they were in sleep, but the colleagues came back with more raiders, about 200 of them, and they surrounded the picket. Now this Kotli was more of an island. In the sense, it is an enclave in army terms. So Jhelum, the boundary between J&K and Pakistan, ran along Jhelum. But this part of this patch was across Jhelum, and boundary there took a bit of twist. So to their back was Jhelum, and in front was a boundary, and in between there was a small patch of land called Kotli enclave. And there was a village, predominantly of Sikh civilians. So all those people had come to Santaram. Santaram had issued them weapons. They also had their own weapons, locally made, and they held back and they fought back 2 attacks. By around 4 o'clock, they decided in the morning, that today, the 23rd October, they said it will be difficult to hold on. They were running short of ammunition, so they pulled out. There was a footbridge made of rope which connected the Kohala Road coming from going towards up to the Dumail, Muzaffarabad, and of course turning right to Srinagar. So they crossed the bridge while fire was on, and then they cut the ropes. So they got some kind of margin and they got away. But as they came on the road, they saw many lorries coming down the road from Dumail side. So what they did, they just crossed the road and vanished into the jungle. Now it is their navigation skill. 9 soldiers with about 50 odd refugees, they were now onto themselves, lost in the wilderness, and that was what happened in Kotli. Further south, 1 company of Jack Riff, same 4 Jack Riff, was holding defenses near Kohala. Kohala was a place where a big bridge over Jhelum connected J&K with Pakistan. So moment the Dumail garrison had been raided on 22nd, the communication network had broken down. Lieutenant Lab Singh was the company commander, and he was not really aware what is happening in Dumail. But some kind of battle noises were heard off and on, though Kohala is very far off. But since raiders were now coming down to Kotli and plundering villages along the road down south, so he had that inkling that something bad is happening, but he had no way of ascertaining it. Now, as a true soldier, he said, okay, I'll hold on. Unless until told to move from this place, I will not move. But what he did, and that mattered a lot, his company was spread out in different platoons, and there was a platoon of another company under him. So he got all of them together, consolidated the defenses, and occupied a position away from the conventional position, where there was a good dominance on the area around. Now, the early morning, Brigadier Rajendra Singh orders Captain Prithi Singh to take 2 platoons and move ahead of Uri, and to go and see as to what has been happening, because even then there's a lot of ambiguity at that time. So Captain Prithi Singh moves up. First party he meets is a group of 4 people, 1 JCO and 3 jawans, survivors of Dumail, wounded and not in a position to really fight, but they are given first aid, and they narrate the whole story to Captain Prithi Singh. they are also taken on board, and Captain Prithi Singh with the two platoons, and they have the vehicles, they move on towards Muzaffarabad. A bit later, they are met by Santram and his 9 men and those 50-odd refugees who had come from Kotli, and they had hit this highway, Muzaffarabad-Srinagar highway, ahead of Uri. Now, those people having survived that, those two attacks and all that, now again joined the force, and as the luck would have it, none of them probably survived later on. Refugees were told to carry on, keep moving to the east towards Baramulla, Uri and Baramulla, while troops moved there. Slightly ahead, there was a blind turn, and at the blind turn, both the parties, Jack State Infantry Party under Captain Prithi Singh, and raiders coming from other side, they were taken aback because they were not really expecting each other. Raiders were told that there will be nobody after Fort Jaggery falls in Dumel, and they'll have a free run to Srinagar. They can go plunder Srinagar, plunder treasury of Maharaja, capture Maharaja alive, force him make sign instrument of accession, and of course capture airfield, so that nobody from India, no army could ever land. They were not prepared to confront another force after fall of Fort Jaggery in Dumel. So Captain Prithi had good situational awareness. He deployed one platoon on the height to the left of the road, and with one platoon on the road, they started waiting for the people to come. When a few vehicles came in front, they opened fire. Captain Prithi Singh actually ran towards the invaders, killed the driver of the first bus, lorry, and he drove back. But while he was driving back and there was no communication, the platoon which was sitting on top under Subedar Duni Chand, who was a war veteran of World War II, that platoon opened fire, taking that vehicle which was coming from opposite direction belonged to raiders. The vehicle was punished in a way that all tires were burst and every radiator, everything leaked, and the vehicle became immobilized. Captain Prithi Singh actually got hit. He got injured, but he came out and came back towards his platoon. The vehicle was now parked on the road, in the middle of the road, and that actually halted the move of those 300-400 odd lorries which were up behind. And then started a day-long battle. 30 people, one platoon under Duni Chand on the hillock. Captain Prithi Singh wounded, and many people who were fighting along with him along the road were getting eliminated by minutes. And even then, they held on. It was one that rare battle which we just simply forgot. It was no less than Saragadi. Saragadi at least had a fort. And here, there were 30 people, a platoon, against 6,000. No defenses, no trenches, not even adequate ammunition. And by evening, that platoon had perished. But this action of holding back raiders for one full day between Uri and Dumel gave Brigadier Rajendra Singh enough time to study ground and redeploy. In his assessment, and rightfully so, he found Uri to be a place which was not fit for defenses. It was dominated from all sides by high features, and there was, of course, Jhelum next to it. So he, in his wisdom, and rightfully so, decided to fall behind Uri. So Uri was told to evacuate, and there was a bridge between Uri and to the east, that is towards Baramulla, between Baramulla and Uri, next to Uri. The remainder of those 60 odd people, men under Brigadier Rajendra Singh, they took a position there. And now there's a panic in Uri, because Uri earlier had thought that residents had thought now army has come, they'll be saved. But when they were told that no, we need to abandon Uri, so they started moving back. Brigadier Rajendra Singh kept on holding the position, enabling every possible refugee to come back, as many refugees to get across behind him as possible. But morning at around on 24th, that is, of course, I'll cover tomorrow, whole night, whole day on 23rd and whole night 24th, they were in position holding the bridge while invaders, now inching over onto Uri, started plundering Uri. 23rd evening, or maybe around last night, Uri was taken over by invaders. Prithi Chand had been evacuated, and he came back. Whatever remainder of the force joined Brigadier Rajendra Singh force. So today is 23rd. Around last light, Brigadier Rajendra Singh and his 60 odd men are sitting on the shot of Uri bridge. He in fact had to go back to Baramulla to speak to his Maharaja and pass orders to Brigadier Fakir Singh, who was the commander of Kashmir Brigade, to order one battalion or one company from Punch to cross Haji Pir and join him in Uri. Also, one more company of four Jackery was in Kupwada. They were also told to fetch forward and join his men at around Uri, between Uri and Baramulla. So he was trying to the best he could do to muster his forces. About couple of sections also came along from Srinagar with some ammunition that night. So 23rd, this was a station in Uri, in Kohala, and of course Kotli, which had been evacuated. To the north of Muzaffarabad, the road goes towards Thithwal, Gurez, and onto that, and finally goes over to Dras in Ladakh. Along that road, there was one platoon of Dogras under Subedar Hukma Singh. Another platoon of four Jackriff of Muslims was to its rear, and the platoon commander was a Muslim, Subedar Waz Khan, and Subedar Hukma Singh was in charge of platoon, which was very close to international border, sitting on a height. On 23rd itself, in the morning, he got a SOS call from Subedar Waz Khan, saying that his platoon is under attack and Hukma Singh should come for his rescue. By that time, Hukma Singh had been watching Muzaffarabad was visible. He could see smoke billowing up in Muzaffarabad, the mail. A news of carnage at Muzaffarabad had reached him. He was kind of a witness to it from a distance. His intuition told him that he should not trust Waz Khan. Though Waz Khan was his same battalion, they had fought together in World War II. He made up a story and told Waz Khan, no, he said, even I am under attack. So you fend for yourself, I'll fend for myself. That actually saved them because Waz Khan had actually planned a trap. Invaders had already reached Waz Khan and now they were wanting this platoon to come back to rescue so-called Waz Khan under stress and then kill them. So that trap, he didn't fall. By last light of 23rd October, Hukma Singh and his band of men were holding on to their position. The place was called Batika, the Batika platoon post. And they had only two or three Muslim jawans. And by the way, all the Muslims were Punchis. They were not Kashmiris. Back in the palace, there was a turmoil, of course. News by now, Maharaja was very clear about what was happening because Brigadier Rajendra Singh had been able to come back to Baramulla and pass on the information accurately. And attempts were being made to convince Government of India to send troops. In Delhi, Nehruji was still adamant that Sheikh Abdullah's Congress was required, and Mountbatten was playing his part. We must not forget that this whole conspiracy of taking Kashmir by force, annexing Gilgit illegally, was a plan made by Britishers. Pakistan Army was just born. They didn't have wherewithal, nor they had that kind of planning capabilities. So planning had started much early, maybe in June, July. Or if you go back to history and read about Governor Cohengam and Lord Ismay, one may feel, it started in 46 itself. So nothing much was happening in Delhi as regards Jammu is concerned. Panic in Srinagar had started, but National Conference cadre under Sheikh Abdullah were getting mobilized. A civil defense force was created, and even women of Kashmir Valley, they picked up weapons. Whatever weapons they could muster, it were musketry rifles or swords and even sticks and clubs. So people were now patrolling the street, and their slogans were like, okay, let the invaders come, we'll take them on. So this was a scene on 23rd, very dismal for Maharaja and his Prime Minister and his state. However, Brigadier Rajendra Singh was still in control of station to some extent, though he knew that he couldn't sit on at Uri forever because terrain there, people who've been there to Uri, they'll understand that the terrain is such that people can infiltrate, people can bypass. You can keep sitting on the road and a party can cross the Jhelum and move along towards Baramulla or climb the mountains to the left, to the south, and carry on to Baramulla while road is then becomes irrelevant. But the road had a significance because the lorries and all the buses, that were very beloved properties of invaders because they had the plans to pick up girls, loot everything and take it back in the lorries. So lorries was, presence of lorries and buses was kind of central to tribesmen. They had no love lost, there no jihad, nothing. It was money and women, and for that, all those things to carry back, they wanted lorries. And to that extent, Brigadier Rajendra Singh sitting on the road and denying that road to invaders was something which was bothersome for Pakistani invaders. So this is 23rd. We'll speak over 24th October, what happened tomorrow. Jai Hind.